So hi everyone, I think today's session is focused on reviewing the key amendments to Companies Act 2013 since it has come into effect, which was in April of 2014. So before we sort of dive into the topic, I just thought I'll take a minute to introduce myself and give you also a structure and you know, overall breakup of how the presentation will proceed. So my name is Aishwarya. I'm an alumnus of National Law School of India, University Bangalore, Bengaluru now actually. Yeah, and I'm also a lawyer with about 10 years of experience doing corporate law. My focus has been on doing M&A and corporate commercial transaction and advisory. So with that background, I would like to now just give you a sense of how the presentation has been structured and what is the overall approach that we will be taking in today's session. So firstly, I think as you may have gleaned from the title, what we're looking at here is you know, a bit of sort of overall view of what the changes to Companies Act has been through legislative amendments since it has come into effect. So as all of you may know, Companies Act 2013 was brought into effect on 1st April 2014. And this legislation was quite important, definitely, because I think it was nearly almost 50 years after the 1956 Companies Act of 1956 that the corporate law of India was reviewed and new legislation was brought into effect, namely the 2013 Act. The path of the 2013 Act itself was rather long. And if some of you may know the history of it, initially it was introduced as a bill in 2009. Then it was reintroduced as a bill in 2011. There were about a couple of rounds of review with standing committee, etc. And eventually the 2013 Act in its current form was enacted and brought into effect substantially on April 2014. Now, this act itself was hailed as being, you know, landmark or historic for many reasons. I think a big impetus for the amendment and updating of the act was that it was felt that the 1956 Act did not reflect subsequent developments in how companies are run and companies operate in real world. Secondly, there was an a feeling that the Indian Companies Act needs to be updated to bring it in line with what were the global developments across other jurisdictions, key jurisdictions which typically we have kept pace with in the past. And I think third, the objective was to obviously make the act and its operation and implementation much more easier. So with a view to all of these objectives, the 2013 Act was brought into effect. And it was a much shorter act. Of course, I think some would argue that that was achieved by putting a lot of the substantive content into rules. And I think that is definitely a key feature of the 2013 Act. But nonetheless, from 56 to 2013 was a fairly big jump. Now, I think maybe it's just useful to stop at this moment and just explain why I am giving you the background of how the 2013 Act came into effect. I think really today's session is about identifying and maybe taking an overall view of what are the changes and developments in the 2013 Act since it has come into effect. So what I guess we're trying to bring out is the fact that the 2013 Act itself was brought in after a pretty long review process, as well as you know, making a lot of updates and bringing in significant changes. So therefore, it is now interesting to see that after having gone through this period of moving from 56 to 2013, what are the changes that the legislature has decided to pursue, or what have been the priorities in the changes or themes, if I can put it that way, that come through in the subsequent changes that have taken place from I think this is the period from 2014 to 21. So a good period of about 6 to 7 years where we have the ability to see what are the key changes that the parliament has put through in this legislation. So I think this also, you know, is a good point for me to explain the overall approach in this particular session. The idea is not to go through each amendment line by line, or to explain the legal implications of specific changes, or to explain, you know, what was the penalty before, what is the penalty now. That is not how we are going to approach this, because I think that is definitely a good exercise, but something that perhaps you know, has a different objective in mind. The idea here is to give you a broad overview of the way in which the law has moved in recent times, and the way in which perhaps you are likely to see continuing changes in this legislation as we move forward. Just very quickly breaking down the structure of the presentation, I think there are sort of three key topics, or really three sections that I've chosen to pick up for today. The first has been on decriminalization of offenses. So basically, very briefly, as you would all know, the Companies Act has a significant number of offenses penalty. So pretty much all substantive sections carry an offense for non-compliance. And over and above that, there is also the residual provision which applies where no other prescription of penalty or offense has been given in the Act. The second, so one key driver in the changes over the last few years has been to reduce the number of criminal offenses under the Companies Act. So this is the first section that we will delve into. The second has a section that I plan to pick up on is the concept of significant beneficial ownership, or SBO, as it is popularly called. So again, this is a new concept which has come in between Companies Act of 2017, 18, 19. And this has caused significant debate and discussion, at least in the legal fraternity, and a lot of debate around how it has been implemented. So that is why I think this is also an important change, and something which is a little different from how the 1956 Act and the prior legislations have thought about these issues. The last grouping, I think, are some of the other key changes. They are driven by three or four key ideas. I think the biggest one amongst them is ease of doing business and to make compliance easy and less burdensome. So these are kind of the three areas that we will pick up to look at an overview of what the changes have been in Companies Act since 2014 April. I just want to spend a minute here on the approach. I already mentioned that I will not be going into a line by line deconstruction of each amendment or explaining to you what was the provision earlier or what is the provision now. I think the idea is just to give you an idea of the evolution of law and the direction in which it is moving. And just want to clarify two things here. One, definitely there has been an element of picking and choosing while creating this presentation in terms of identifying what I feel are some significant changes. So obviously there may be some other items that you may feel are significant, or others may feel, which are not covered here. So that is something just to keep in mind, that this is not an exhaustive list of all changes that have happened. And the second one I want to highlight is that a key area which I will not cover in this, simply because that is an entire topic in itself, is the interplay between IBC and Companies Act 2013. So as you all may know, the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016 has come into effect, which has majorly revamped the insolvency winding up provisions, liquidation provisions, as applicable to Indian corporate and Indian companies. So because now there is a separate code, a lot of the provisions relating to winding up and liquidation have either been removed from the Companies Act, or they have been substantially modified. But again, like I said, that is a separate topic in itself and not something that we would be covering in today's session. So with that preamble, I think let's start with part one. So part one deals with decriminalization of offenses. Now, as you would realize that decriminalization is really sort of two parts to it. One is very simply, as the word implies, removing imprisonment as offense. Removing imprisonment as a consequence of offenses under the Companies Act. And the second aspect of decriminalization has been the fact of moving certain offenses from criminal wrongs to bringing them under civil penalty framework. So why this is important, I think it should take a minute to explain. Adjudication of a criminal offense versus a civil offense stands on a different footing on some key areas. So one is that a criminal offense generally is a much more complicated proceeding, and the burden of proof is also of a higher degree. It is beyond reasonable doubt. Whereas a civil offense penalty stands on a lesser footing, and it is typically what I think Supreme Court has described in one of its cases as adjudication for blameworthy conduct rather than establishing criminal intent or any kind of intentional wrongdoing. And this element of not having to prove intent becomes very important in actually achieving enforcement and ensuring that these offenses are proved and fined or imprisoned or you know, action is taken against them, because it is much easier for the authorities to prosecute a civil liability and to show that an offense has happened, and therefore to achieve in that sense better implementation of the Companies Act framework. Now, why is this important if we sort of just take a step back? I mean, of course, on paper it sounds great that the result of violation of offense is in imprisonment, or it is a criminal finding of fine or imprisonment or both. But actually, if you think about and you look at how law is implemented and the efficacy of prosecution of its violations, we'd find that the easier it is to prosecute and show wrongdoing, perhaps we'd find a higher degree of compliance with that law. And secondly, it would be easier for the authorities as well to catch more of the offenses that happen. Whereas if we keep the standard very high at criminal imprisonment, then of course on paper it is a much more serious outcome, but we may find that we reach that outcome much less often, resulting in overall the fact that the violations of that particular law are less likely to be caught or enforced. So this is sort of one line of thinking on why civil penalties are better. I think the second aspect why this has been sort of a key driver for the government of India in recent times is the fact that globally, in most jurisdictions, a lot of corporate offenses have moved to the area of civil penalties or civil liabilities rather than criminal. And this is something that typically comes up a lot when India is thinking of things like encouraging foreign investment. So if you have a foreign resident or a foreign national who wants to be a director of an Indian company, and typically when they approach us for understanding what are their duties under the Indian Companies Act as a director of an Indian company, they're often shocked to find that a lot of the things or violations which perhaps are not so serious would result in them being subject to criminal activity, which globally is a very high bar. So I think that is the second key impetus behind decriminalization of offenses. So just to recap, I think one, the fact that it's definitely seen as more effective to be able to prosecute and implement civil penalties. Second, I think the idea to bring India in line with global standards on corporate wrongdoing and liability. And third, and I think this is a very India-specific reason, is the fact that our current judicial system is, there is such high levels of pendency that anything, any kind of overall structures or actions which help move cases away from the judicial system and into the into an adjudicatory mechanism or a civil mechanism is always encouraged and a priority for the government to ensure that we can bring down the overall level of judicial pendencies. So with this kind of background, I think I just want to sort of draw your attention to this statement on the screen, which says that, and this is really the heart of what the government has been trying to do in recent times. They want to make sure that if something is procedural, any offence of the Companies Act is procedural, is technical in nature, or it is not serious, then it should be viewed as a civil penalty. Whereas any conduct which is of a high degree of impact on public interest or fraudulent conduct, or which is a very serious offence, should continue to be to result in criminal penalties or imprisonment. So this division of what is procedural, technical, minor versus serious fraudulent conduct, that really determines what is the outcome of violation of a specific provision under the Companies Act. And it is this division into procedural, technical, minor versus serious fraudulent that the committees and the sort of company law committee set up by the MCA in the last few years have been reviewing. And as a result of that review, they have come up with some suggestions on how to recategorize some of the offenses under Companies Act. So just to give you the chronology, I think the first time I think there was a high-level committee formed to review offenses in 2017, I believe, and I think their report was submitted in 2018. Now, as a result of this, and what was actually put into this report and their recommendations, we'll get into in a minute. But what this resulted in was certain changes being made to the Companies Act, which were first brought into effect as an ordinance in 2018, which ordinance was again re-promulgated. And eventually, it resulted in the Companies Act Amendment of 2019, which is obviously now in effect. But subsequently, the government felt that the offenses and decriminalization needs to be accelerated. And a second committee was set up, or rather, given the task of reviewing again the categorization of offenses. And this committee, the Company Law Committee, submitted its report in 2019, which has now resulted in the latest amendment to Companies Act, which is the Companies Amendment Act of 2020, which was recently in February of this year brought into effect. So just getting into a bit of the details, just to give you a sense of what has been the way in which these committees and their subsequent recommendations have been implemented. So first, let's pick up the Companies Amendment Act of 2019. I think the headline here was that they took 16 offenses which were punishable prior to the amendment with either imprisonment or fine or both, and they changed them into a category where the only effect could be a civil penalty. Now, I've put on the screen a few examples, and if you go through this, you may also wonder that why were these serious enough to be construed as offenses which should result in imprisonment. So, for example, prohibition of issue of shares at a discount. Now, just to walk through this, yes, of course, there is a bar under the Indian Companies Act on issuing shares at a discount, which is typically a creditor protection mechanism. And companies, for example, if a company's share has face value of 10 rupees, they cannot issue a share of face value 5 because there is a expectation of maintenance of certain amount of capital. However, if for whatever reason, and frankly, this very rarely happens, but if there is at all issuance which is at below the face value of the shares, this would invite imprisonment or fine. So again, you know, similarly, failure or delay in filing financial statement, which is section 137, subsection 3. Now, of course, financial statements are a very important document, perhaps one of the most important documents put out by the company annually. And obviously, it gives picture of its financial health and assets and liabilities. And, you know, nobody can deny that it is very important. But the fact that any failure or delay could result in criminal imprisonment or fine seemed an excessive outcome, especially when the reasons for the delay or failure to file these statements could be myriad, and they may not always be on account of an intentional action or you know, with an intent to hide or obfuscate the dealings of the company. So for example, if for whatever reason there is a change in auditor, the auditor has resigned and you had to get a new auditor to come in place, and they have to restart the process of doing the audit, that could result in a delay in filing your financial statements. Now, is this something that the directors in question should be imprisoned for? Is really a question that we should ponder on. So these are the kind of examples where the committee felt, and subsequently the government agreed and put it into the Amendment Act to say that we can deal with all of these in terms of a monetary penalty. So the idea is, yes, of course, there should be an outcome, and shouldn't be that you are able to violate these laws with impunity, but the result has to have a degree of proportionality considering the offense in the first place. The second key change that was brought in here was an in-house adjudication mechanism. I think this is linked to our reference earlier, the civil penalty mechanism, civil liability framework rather. And here the idea is that for these kind of offenses, the adjudication, because it's deemed that these adjudications are relatively straightforward, objective determinations, which can perhaps be done with a lot of the information which is already available with the Ministry of Corporate Affairs through the company's annual filings. And there isn't any detailed adjudication or finding of law or facts which is required to make out an offense in these cases. In all such cases, the committee suggested that an adjudicating officer or AO, as they are called, would be the first person to review the offense and to suggest a civil penalty, which could then be appealed to the regional director of the MCA. So I think, again, the idea here has been to, if you recall, we identified sort of three key objectives of the decriminalization: to move matters away from NCLT and declog the judicial pendency. So this in-house adjudication mechanism is an example where they feel that moving away matters from the tribunals would help in you know, declogging the NCLT. The third item here we should speak about is the fact that while the committee did review all of the offenses, and there's a detailed categorization if you were to go through the committee's report, they did find that they did not feel that it was appropriate to recommend any change in non-compoundable offenses. Now here, the reference to non-compoundable offenses, maybe I can just take a minute to explain. Under the Companies Act, any offense that is punishable with imprisonment only or imprisonment fine cannot be compounded, and other offenses can be compounded, which means that they can be put through the adjudication mechanism. So this was, in a way, a barometer of the seriousness of the offense. So what was done in this particular Amendment Act was there was no change made in the non-compoundable offenses. In other words, what were kept as serious offenses were retained as is, and status quo was maintained on that. So moving on, the next aspect of this decriminalization was, I think, the Companies Amendment Act of 2020. So after the 2019 Act came into effect, the Government of India still felt that there were a high number of offenses which could result in criminal wrongdoing under the Companies Act. And, you know, perhaps this was not really this thing to ease of doing business in India. So they again constituted the Company Law Committee, which continued the work that the previous high-level committee had done and came up with further suggestions. So again, I'm not going to go into the details of these offenses. I think these are easily available in public domain, but just to give you an overall idea of how they approached this, they divided the offenses. I think they dealt with about 46, if I remember correctly, 46 offenses, and they divided them into certain categories and said that this is the approach. So for certain items which under the Companies Act were simply offenses for non-compliance of order of NCLT or another authority, they said that you know, to make the non-compliance of an order itself an offense is kind of a duplication, because the NCLT in this case would already have sufficient powers and be able to use its own contempt jurisdiction to take action against anybody who violates NCLT orders. So that's why they felt that these offenses could be removed as separate offenses under the Companies Act. Then the second step that they did was to simply say that certain offenses are not you know, at the standard which requires imprisonment. So that was, again, quote unquote, decriminalization. The third item that they did was a continuation of what was done in the previous act, which is certain offenses which were punishable with fine or imprisonment or both were made punishable with penalties only, civil penalties only. Again, this committee also did not make any change in non-compoundable offenses. And in certain cases, they said that there may be alternate methods of prescribing sanctions rather than construing it as an offense. So I think one of the examples which the committee had suggested is that if there is a non-availability of name and that order of the RD is not followed, then it can just be that the company is required to adopt the name which is suggested by the RD as a mandatory matter until time that it can come up with a name which is then available. So these were the kind of ideas and approaches that the committee had suggested, which the Companies Amendment Act has put into effect, with the overall result now that we have a much more simplified offenses framework under the Companies Act, with a clear delineation between what can result in simple civil penalty and higher standard of offenses, which could result in criminal imprisonment or fines or both.